Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our panellists, the Global Vice Chair for Public Policy at Ernst & Young and founder of the EY Women's Athletes Business Network, Beth Brooke Marciniak, IOC Member, President of the International Triathlon Union and Chair of the IOC Gender Equality Review Working Group, Marisol Casado, the President of the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee and Caribbean Association of National Olympic Committees and member of the IOC Gender Equality Review Project Working Group, Brian Lewis, and United Nations Under-Secretary General and Executive Director of UN Women, Pumzile Mlambo Nguka. Moderating today's conversation is Vice President of the International Sport Press Association and news producer at the Olympic Channel, Evelyn Watta.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, ladies, for joining us. Thank you. We have made great steps to advance gender equality over the years. We need to expand upon this forward momentum to build a world where there's universal rights for women and men. From girls practicing sports to those of us working in sports, there's no doubt that we are talented and aspire to lead. But women are still not getting into the leadership because of our gender. Much remains to be done to ensure that women and girls get equal opportunities to succeed, provide fair and equal pay, and are protected from discrimination, harassment, and abuse. This panel will discuss the challenges women in sport face in terms of gender equality, and also seek to explore how sport can be used as a tool for empowering women and girls to move towards gender equality. We'll start right away. Gender equality, as I've said, has come a long way, but there's still a lot more that needs to be done. How do you think the gender equality landscape has evolved over the years, both in business, for someone like Beth, and in sports, for Brian and Marisol, and even in the UN, for Pumzile, over the last 10 years? Let's start with Beth.
Thank you very much, Evelyn. Delighted to be here. I would say, just in general, one quick statistic. The World Economic Forum every year does an annual gender gap report where they measure the progress for women's equality. And this past year, they said that it would take 217 years until we have parity between men and women. So, and that's actually getting worse from the year before. So while in business, my sector, it feels like we're making progress, across the four dimensions that the World Economic Forum looks like, it's actually going backwards.
What do you think, Marisol?
Well, about the sport, I think quite positive in this moment. I think I've been working in this area for nearly 20 years in this moment, and also the Olympic Committee. And I have to say that in the last 10 years, or even in the last 5 years, we make a really a huge progress. Just, I understand that the society, especially the International Olympic Committee family, understand that this is something very important for us, just to play a role model for the rest of the sport organizations. Then, as the International Olympic Committee is just all together with the NOCs and the international federations, all the world. I am very, very happy to announce that after the review of that we make the past year, let's say, the implementation phase in which we are now is really very encouraging. It's very important to understand that we had a very good study case in this moment, as it was very important that from the leadership of the organization, from President Bach, and the leadership also of the Director General, Christophe de Kepper, to the end of all the staff people in the IOC, they were really committed to this project. This is the beauty that we have in our hands in this moment. Then we have to work very closely with national Olympic committees. I know that they are working, and especially, very especially, with the international federations, because they are a little bit behind.
Great. Is that correct, Bran? Is what Marisol is saying true?
Well, significant progress has been made over the years, given where the, in the case of the Olympic movement and sport, where it has come from no women to women in terms of participation. I think the real conversation is that notwithstanding the progressive measures put in place and the progressive leadership that we have at the Olympic movement, why is it that in the context of leadership and decision making, we haven't kept pace with modern progress? I mean, it's still abysmally low, and I think that is where the real conversation needs to take place. Why, notwithstanding all the best intentions, there is still, to people looking on, lip service and empty gestures.
Thank you, Brian. What do you think, Pumzile? What is the journey for us towards gender equality? Where are we at?
Well, thank you so much for the opportunity to be here. One of the important to make is that there isn't a country that has attained gender equality. So sports reflects the reality of society, but it also reflects the fact that there's a lot of resilience and dedication and leadership that is trying to move us forward, even ahead of society. The fact that we will be having 50-50 participation of both girls and boys by 2020 is a big step. It does not reflect what happens in real society. There's hardly gender parity in most institutions in society. What this demonstrates is that with leadership, determination, you can actually outperform society. And the message to leaders is that leaders must lead from the front, because you can make a difference and outperform society, which is what sports people do. They outperform.
Perfect. So it shows that it shows that giving women and girls access to sports is a good way to help us empower them, and in any way, the best way to achieve gender equality. So how do you think sport can affect the gender equality landscape? I'll start with you, Bran. You're one man who's been walking the talk in terms of this. How do you think sport can affect the gender equality landscape?
Well, sports is seen by almost everyone throughout the world, regardless of gender or geography, as a powerful tool to make a positive difference in the lives of young people, children, and society. And sports has taken on such a powerful cultural dimension now in the world that essentially where sport goes, I think the world will follow. And the responsibility and onus on sport leaders is to embrace that responsibility and challenge. We can't, notwithstanding the challenge, the progress we have made, be complacent. And you know, in the context of gender equality as distinct from sexual equality, there is a huge thing that we are required to have a more nuanced discussion on the whole concept of gender equality and gender justice. Because most of the conversations to date have been based on a heteronormative, binary, gender binary concept of sex and gender. And I think that that is probably the root cause of why we may not have made the kind of progress that we need to make, because we are locked into the challenges of yesterday, today, and tomorrow in the context of sport being a male-dominated bastion and citadel. And you know, there are deep-rooted and deep-seated cultural dimensions that need to be challenged.
Marisol, do you agree with this?
Well, yes, but I think that it's very important just to be very positive in the way that we are working in this moment. I think sport is so important and powerful tool for empowerment of women that for sure makes a big difference. The portrayal of the, that's why we have to work very much about the portrayal of the women in the sport is so big, so strong, when you see images on the TV, etc., etc., that for sure that make a difference. I think in this moment we can set samples very clear in countries, as for example my country, which is Spain, that team events are very, very important. And in this moment, just they make this click already on the Spanish TV, and we are having the basketball women's events complete and everything, and for sure the society changed immediately. And then it's very clear to see that it doesn't matter if it's men or women, if you like basketball, you sit down in your TV and watch the event. I think it's very important.
Let me add to that, Evelyn. I think sport can make an enormous difference in the gender equality equation. And I give you the business perspective on this. At EY, the organization I'm affiliated with, we simply want more women in leadership. We know the benefit of that. So we started something called the Women Athletes Business Network to help elite transition into business because we wanted more women in leadership. We did some research and found, we researched women at the senior levels of business, so women in the C-suite, CEOs, COOs, CFOs. We found that women in the C-suite, 94% of them had played sports, almost every one of them. And over half had played at a university level. What's that tell us? It doesn't tell us that playing sports as a girl is going to put you in the C-suite, mm-hmm. but it says, playing sports equips you with what it takes as a woman to get ultimately to the highest levels of business or the highest levels of sports leadership of any sort. And so I think the sport for women has an enormous power to change this landscape.
Fumzila, you mentioned that we can continue using sports to advance this the gender equality. And you are a champion, you've been a champion to advance the women's rights. Do you think that using sports is a right way to get to the numbers that we are looking at? Yeah.
It's one important and essential intervention we have, but it cannot only be sports. Otherwise, I think we'd be simplifying the challenges of gender inequality. Yes. To the extent that from a very young age, every child has a possibility to play sports. It's an important avenue to open to every child. Even if they don't become a winner, they become a team player. They learn how to be in solidarity with others. They learn discipline. All of those are essential and important attributes to have and to take with them. And for girl children, the thirst for success and to win can always be important for them later on in life when they are going to face challenges. But we must not take sports in isolation. The ecosystem of society has to change overall in order to make it possible for the girls to thrive. The fact that girls drop out of sports during puberty, even if they do well in sports, even if the sports fraternity, the teachers who are coaches, etc., have done their fair share to encourage them to play sports, but they can get teased when they reach puberty, when their bodies change, and then all this good work that has been done to keep them in sport is actually lost. So the whole ecosystem, parents have to be part of this in order to make sure that the girls are encouraged to feel good about who they are and to not feel put down easily. If a girl gets a boyfriend who's a jerk and a potato couch and she's sporty, she could be discouraged by the jerk. So, you know, we need to make sure that she must feel strong.
So if I hear you correctly, there are barriers that we are yet to overcome. Marisol and Brian, you're both sports leaders. How do you think we can overcome these barriers and get more women on the menu, even as we look at getting more women on the table?
The reality is that for it to happen, men have to give way. You know, while it is a necessary conversation, what is the reality? The reality is that in the 21st century, when you look at the makeup of most Olympic movement organizations, and you walk into a room, whether it is at the continental level or the national level, it's mainly men. It's still a boys' club. So how do we change that? Men who create the bottleneck have to have the vision and the commitment to gender equality and decide that just as they will mentor men, they will mentor women. There needs to be a sense of urgency. This is the 21st century. The Olympic movement needs to better reflect at the decision-making level the real world that we live in. And it's not just about saying that the world is made up of half woman, half male. That puts it into a very binary sexuality conversation. It's about gender. It's about the diversity across the gender spectrum. And unless the Olympic movement, in addition to the tremendous work being done, whether it is by Agenda 2020, whether it is by the Gender Review Project, Equality Project recommendation, there must be a commitment by leaders who are mainly men to do something concrete and practical.
Yeah. I completely agree with him, of course. But I want just to put a little bit more. I have to answer this question in many occasions. Unfortunately, I'm the only president for the Summer Olympics International Federations. And when I have to answer this, I always say that my idea of freedom bring me to this position. This is always I say, and I want to say with that we have to encourage women. At this moment, I assume that we already remove some barriers through the even in the way of arriving just to the leadership in the international federations, just with some different ways, with quotas or with the, other means, just promoting whatever. Then now I think we have to be very careful just to give a good image to the women's, because in my opinion, one of the things is just the leadership in the sport is not the most appealing for anyone, men or women, but especially for women. Then we have to work very much in this idea, because women's, when you offer something, normally they say yes. But when they have to do the step by themselves, still is very difficult to do it.
Beth, do you agree? Because from a business perspective, what do you think? Should we go the voluntary way or should we go the quota way, as Marisol mentioned? That it's been a discussion that's even within my own association. Women are not taking our positions. So what have you seen working in the business sector that can be transferred to the sports sector to get more women on the board?
Well, just do it is part of it. But we've studied countries that have actually made progress in companies, and we've boiled it down to three essential things, and I think they apply very well here in the sports world, which is the first thing you need is a voice. And in a country, what you need is government to use its voice to call for action. If I translate to the sports sector, that's the IOC. That is President Bach calling for action. And it's a gender equality review project. So it's using the voice to call for change. Then secondly, in the business world, it's the private sector taking action visibly. In the sports world, that's the NOCs, that's the federations, that's Brian, that's Marisol, taking action to have the right tone at the top, to institute accountability and measures, and then to just simply take the concrete actions that you both described. And then the third thing that you have to have is transparency, which means you've got the IOC saying what needs to be done, you've got the NOCs, the federations actually starting to take action, and then you need transparency around, are we making progress? So that we all can look at it and say, yeah, we're making progress, or no, we're not. What else do we need to be doing? And we can give voice to it. And then the voice can come back in and say, we're doing some things right, we're not doing some things right. Universally around the world, it takes those things. And they all have to be there. When you're not making progress, usually it's because that voice is missing. No one's really calling for it. You've got Brian and Marisol trying to do the right things, but nobody's really calling for it. So they're isolated and on their own. So we really have the combination of those three things, and I think you've got a great framework here that's in progress.
And exactly, and the Olympic Charter is clear. It's encouraging support and the promotion of women in sport at all levels. Fumzile, do you think this is the right way to go, or should we do more, as Beth is saying, within the Olympic and the sporting world?
There's always room for more, because once for more work. And sustained work, because once we become complacent, there's a risk that you could actually slip back. It's also important to have special measures and to invest in the initiatives that will propel the change that you're seeking. I don't think that the progress that we have seen in sports would have happened if it wasn't determined by investment, by targets, by time frames. It will just not happen by itself. I think that quotas do work, they make a difference. There's hardly any way in the world when we've seen women moving forward without any special measure. The patriarchy is too resilient, actually, to enable women to move forward without extraordinary investment, support, leadership, and emphasis. There is always going to be a need for extra work to be done. In the same way as if men were underrepresented, we would need to do that. So there's a minimum threshold below which none of the genders should be absent in order to make sure that you have true diversity. It's also important to have a gender not just as binary, to also be broad-minded about it, as he has been saying. It is quite concerning when you feel that there are athletes whose gender is causing them to be at risk. In my country, Caster Semenya, we worry about her and her future. So this whole issue of being inclusive in sports also means that we have to look at the different barriers that could impact on both boys and girls in sports, men and women in sports, and accommodate them in a deliberate way.
And Evelyn, what we can't let happen is to have a barrier be put up that, oh, the women just aren't qualified. When I talked about our program of taking female athletes and helping them after their sport career ends transition into business, a lot of them don't have the skill set to transition into business. And that's not what we're looking for. What they have is the mindset. They have the leadership skills that all three of you described. They know how to succeed. We can't train that into someone. So we hire for mindset, and then we'll teach the skill set. The great thing in the sports world is the female athletes have both the mindset and the skill set. They know the sports world. So there's just no excuse to not make progress.
That's good. So they will get hired. But then the problem is, once they get hired, they don't even get the same pay as the men on the board. There was a report done in 2017 by McKinsey, and it showed that 75% of CEOs have said that they've made gender a priority, you know, in terms of payment and ensuring equal pay, but we are still not there. So we get the women to transition into leadership positions, but it's still a problem. What do you think? What do you think, Bran? You've been really involved in terms of pushing for women in leadership.
Right. So I'm just a little intimidated by the clock running down there, so I know we're going to be out of time fast. So let me just slip in this point. I think that while everything else is taking place, all the institutional efforts and the progressive leadership at the level of the top of the IOC, President Bach is trying to be very progressive. I think there needs to be greater buy-in by the leaders across ANOC, the NOCs, and we need to recognize that there is a problem that we need to address, and it requires a combination of evolution, step-by-step approach, but it also requires a revolution. And I think that some practical step that needs to happen is that we mustn't be afraid to voice that in the history of the IOC, you have never had a woman president. It's time for a woman president. There are many National Olympic Committees that have never had a woman president. It's time for a woman president. It's time for 50-50 gender equality on NOC executives. The time is now. We need to have a sense of urgency. And the current leaders who have a real commitment to gender equality need to stop paying lip service to it.
Marisol, are you so lonely?
Yes, I'm listening.
Yes. Are you lonely as the only president of a summer international federation? Do you want more company or you're content?
No. I really want more company. I think it's quite difficult to be alone. It is. I can say very clear, and especially when you have to confront in an election or something like that is very difficult because the lobbies are masculine or feminine. This is clear. It's for women or for men. Then if you are your own, it's very difficult or very easy to do your own lobby because you have to talk with yourself.
Fumzile and
is
Beth,
the point.
What has been your experience in the business world that we can borrow to make sure that the women are there and they get their worth? They're not just there for the numbers. As a friend says, we don't want to be flower vases, no.
No.
We don't want to be the flower. We want to be on the table because we've earned it and we earn our rights. What can we do in the sporting world?
This is the most important thing. This is one of the most important things. When you have women, if they are related in your board, you have to give them the highest possible work that will be on the organization, really. Otherwise, it's very difficult just to maintain the level.
Fumzile, what do you think we can take? What are some of the lessons we can take to ensure that there is equal pay for our women in sport?
Well, the constituency of sports is very important. The people who fill the stadium must also be very loud on this issue and weigh in. The sponsors need to also pay attention to this issue, because being a sportswoman, it's also a job. People need to be remunerated accordingly for the work that they do. If they are not, it is robbery. And we need solidarity, we need media to call out these kinds of behavior and discrepancies, because it is a human right violation. In sports, as President Bach was saying, we are also talking about human rights. This is a violation of a human right because women's rights are human rights. So we need the pressure both on the rights angle, we need the fans who propel the sport by being the one who pay the fees. We need sponsors to be engaged by their shareholders, by their board, and everyone who can actually make a difference needs to be heard.
Yes.
Beth, the media portrayal of women in sport is very important, right?
Very.
From the athletes you've worked with, what do you think? She mentioned sponsors. if you are a sponsor of a women athlete and you're not getting the heat that you want, is that, does that affect your, the pay the women earns, or even how many other sponsors come on board to support her?
Well, it's clearly, it's all tied together and it's complex, but I even heard a statistic last night that said that in a survey of fans, 80% of the fans wanted to see men and women. They don't want to see just men. And sponsors, I think, need to be, you know, educated on that. I think there needs to be a better understanding, but we also need to see the media, but then, and role models need to be made visible. Extraordinarily visible. People can't be what they can't see. They can't support what they don't know about. So sponsors have a role to play in that. Fans have a role to play. But then we actually need to listen to that and respond.
One thing I can assure the Argentine fans, you'll get to see equal number of women and equal number of men competing here at the Youth Olympic Games. And final take, I'll start with Fumzile as we wrap up the session.
Well, just to pick on the issue of stereotypes and projection of women, not just women in sports, but women in general in the media, it is important to get the marketing and ad companies to take the responsibility to transform themselves. We in UN Women have partnered with more than 50 companies in what is called Unstereotype Alliance, to get the companies to actually transform themselves, to change the way they portray women and girls, because many of us do not have the kind of dollar that these advertising agencies have got. We need them to transform and to lead the transformation of projecting women better. But this is everyone's responsibility. Let's make sports work for both girls and boys, for men and women, because they both bring their A game into it, and we all enjoy when they do that.
Brian, it is your responsibility, right?
If we want to energize this this whole focus, we need to have more Olympic movement presidents who are women, beginning with the International Olympic Committee. And we need to move the conversation now from just women in sport to gender equality, gender justice, diversity, and inclusion.
Marisol? Yeah.
Thank you, I completely agree with them. I think I really would like to put, because I didn't intervene about the equal payment of men and women in the administration and leadership positions. I think one of the most important thing with the panorama that we are having in this moment is transparency. I think it's necessary to know, because now we are in a position where I understand that all the family understand what we are talking about. That was not the case before.
Yes.
Then now transparency is, for me, very, very important.
And Beth?
For me, it's that every one of us in this room has a platform to make change on this issue. And I think we have to think about it in that way. When we think about what we can do as a multinational organization around the world, we think of it as we can control in every country around the world that we operate in what goes on within our four walls. We can't control a country's laws, we can't control a country's culture, but we can control what goes on in the four walls of the Olympic movement. In this room, we control this issue. It's in our power. And I just would ask all of us to internalize what in our sphere of influence can we change to make a difference.
So change lies in all of us. Let's carry on the fight and change this narrative and change also the conversation so that we move from gender equality to gender equity. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, ladies.